Good evening and welcome to this Thursday, December 15th, 2011 InfoWars Nightly News broadcast, a day that will live in infamy. Coming up, we do have Guenter Spens, the former East German officer, in an extended interview to essentially explain how the tyranny in America has come to overshadow even that of the classic police state in East Germany. However, even that is overshadowed by our current news, as the Senate has now passed the indefinite detention bill, 86-13. That after the House passed the defense bill. This is the reconciled version, the one that the president is now expected to sign. Russia Today writes, exactly 220 years to the date after the Bill of Rights was ratified, the U.S. Senate today voted 86-13 in favor of the NDAA for fiscal year 2012, allowing the indefinite detention and torture of Americans. And we are, of course, waiting to see if Obama will sign it as expected, perhaps in the middle of the night, like everything else outside of law. Now, VOA News reports on the House passing the defense bill 283-136, adding that the White House had previously warned of a veto for any bill that challenges or constrains the president's authority to collect intelligence, incapacitate terrorists, and protect the nation. The Obama administration argues that the military law enforcement officials and intelligence agents need flexibility to act on a case-by-case basis. Now, Paul Joseph Watson gets into the whole deception around Obama's previous threat to veto this NDAA bill, which he never had any real intention of doing. He, of course, is for the power to indefinitely detain Americans. He just doesn't want the military to supersede his executive branch power to make that determination. Headline, Obama's U-turn on indefinite detention bill, a historic tragedy for rights. Indeed, it is. The Human Rights Watch has labeled President Obama's U-turn a historic tragedy for rights, adding, by signing this defense bill, President Obama will go down in history as the president who enshrined indefinite detention without trial in U.S. law, said Kenneth Roth, executive director of Human Rights Watch. In the past, Obama has lauded the importance of being on the right side of history. Today, he's clearly on the wrong side. And then Paul Joseph Watson adds, while this is a nice tone from the Human Rights Watch and the ACLU, Obama's veto threat was never about stopping detention without trial of American citizens. It was about ensuring that the federal government didn't completely hand such powers over to the U.S. military and enshrining into law Obama's unconstitutional policy of targeting Americans as terrorists without the legal requirement to offer any proof. How disgusting is this? Now, if this whole controversy over the NDAA bill has been confusing to you, Washington's blog has made it about as simple as possible. They have vowed to explain to a five-year-old why the indefinite detention bill does apply to U.S. citizens on U.S. soil. The bill says that the military must indefinitely detain anyone suspected of helping the bad guys. The article breaks down. One provision says that the mandatory, that is the word must, indefinite detention doesn't apply to U.S. citizens, but the government can indefinitely detain any citizen it feels like without trial. In other words, it's like saying you don't have to lock up Joey for the rest of his life because he called you a mean name, but you can lock him away and throw away the key, then falsely accuse of him being a suspected terrorist if it would make you happy. And that is, in essence, what is in this bill. The determination is whether it's mandatory to indefinitely detain a U.S. American citizen suspected of being involved in Al-Qaeda or terrorism, or whether it's at the president's discretion. Either way, it's total tyranny, totally in violation of the Bill of Rights. Of course, there's a lot of other stuff stuffed into this terrible National Defense Authorization Bill, including Kurt Nemo's NDAA gives the Pentagon green light to wage internet war. The following language is in the final reconciled bill that will now travel to the Senate and ultimately to Obama's desk, where it will be signed into law. Now it has passed the Senate. Despite earlier assertions that he would veto the legislation, Congress affirms that the Department of Defense has the capability and, upon direction by the president, may conduct offensive operations in cyberspace to defend our nation, allies, and interests, subject to the policy, principles, and legal regimes that the department follows for kinetic capabilities, including the law of armed conflict and the War Powers Resolution. It's a bunch of mumbo-jumbo people, all this kinetic action talk. They have instituted total tyranny, and now they're going to go after you on the internet as well. Now, of course, as you see behind me, with Obama prepared to sign, Pennsylvania senators get Twitter bombed over defense bill. Of course, everybody is angry about this bill, rightfully so. They should be most unhappy that Obama is going to sign it after threatening to veto it. Of course, it was never over the indefinite detention. It was over his power as president, because all these presidents have put in an overreach of executive power through their executive orders, their signing statements, and the rest of it. George W. Bush did it. This is just an extension of that. And with that in mind, I just wanted to point out this movie that we have for sale at InfoWars.com. It is Outside the Law, Stories from Guantanamo. I just happened to have watched it last night. It's very relevant, though, given that they have now passed a law claiming the authority to detain indefinitely American citizens. This, of course, gets into a lot of presumably innocent people who are caught up in Guantanamo and all the other secret prisons they don't want to talk about that are overseas, and how those people were detained indefinitely, not given access to lawyers, not even shown their charges. All the alleged evidence was all under classified seal, and it was all just a big kangaroo circus court. Of course, there's real people who got caught up in it. They weren't even members of Al-Qaeda in most cases, largely because people were selling them out. And now this is the kind of abuse of power everyone was so upset about under the George W. Bush administration. Now it's going to happen even to Americans under Obama. Don't you see how the executive tyranny goes on and on with the aid of Congress, of course. Now, with that in mind, I wanted to bring up what we already mentioned right after we play this trailer, and that is the Bill of Rights. So stay tuned, and then Guenter Spens ahead. But first, a trailer from Outside the Law, Stories from Guantanamo.
We were kept there for 2 months, not allowed to speak at all.
1215 at Runnymede, the nobles of England forced Prince John to sign a document called the Magna Carta. The most basic right of that is that no man can be deprived of his liberty except in accordance with the law and by a jury of his peer.
And your hand would be just chained up like that. And
depriving people of that takes you back to the 11th century.
Really horrible, you know, they got barbed wires, they chained you to the barbed wires.
The reason that the Bush administration chose Guantanamo Bay was that they thought they could get away with making it effectively a law-free zone.
It's so frightening because you can hear people screaming every day and night in those top rooms.
The prisoners were assigned numbers. The numbers were put on lists and were sent out to a place called Camp Doha in Kuwait. And the orders that came back from there stipulated that every single Arab who came into U.S. custody had to be sent to Guantanamo.
When I heard these stories, I was just shocked, appalled. And it was everywhere, and every one of them.
Now, that is Outside of Law, Stories from Guantanamo, but now I guess there'll be a follow-up volume, Stories from Americans Detained Indefinitely by the U.S. Military and or the President and or Killed without Charge or Probable Cause by the President. And that is why we wanted to bring up in full the Bill of Rights. Now, what is the Bill of Rights? It wasn't originally part of the Constitution passed in 1789. In fact, it only came about after many states threatened to not ratify the Constitution because of lack of adequate protection from government overreach. Now, a bunch of anti-federalists, one of the factions at the time, were against the centralized power plans of the federalists that included Alexander Hamilton, who was also for the first centralized bank in the country, and people like John Adams and so forth. A bunch of anti-federalists, including Patrick Henry, chief among them, give me liberty or give me death, fought for the Bill of Rights, and eventually they were added. Minus two at the front that had to do with apportionment of Congress and so forth. Those were dropped, but the core 10 were added, and we're going to read them now in full. But I want to first point out the preamble to the Bill of Rights, which explains in one paragraph why they passed it. Of course, this is old language. I know many people went to public school if they got an education at all, so I'll try to break it down for you as well. The conventions of a number of states having at the time of their adopting the Constitution expressed a desire in order to prevent misconstruction or abuse of its powers. that further declaratory and restrictive clauses should be added, and as extending the ground of public confidence in the government will best ensure the beneficent ends of its institution. So it says right there, they added the Bill of Rights to reinforce that the government under the Constitution should have limited powers. Of course, over time, that's been eroded. Various presidents signed into law, the appearance of law, these really arrogant statements saying that basically they don't have to recognize the rule of law or the Bill of Rights, which are specifically protections for the individual and the state and local governments. That's the whole point of it. So you don't have a centralized tyranny all in one place. It's a balance of power, the overall idea of the geniusness behind the Constitution. So without further ado, let's now read the first 10 amendments of the Bill of Rights. The First Amendment, Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof or abridging the freedom of speech or of the press or of the right of the people peaceably to assemble and to petition the government for a redress of grievances. The Second Amendment, a well-regulated militia being necessary to the security of a free state, the right of the people to keep and bear arms shall not be infringed. The Third Amendment, no soldier shall in time of peace be quartered in any house without the consent of the owner, nor in time of war, but in a manner to be prescribed by law. The Fourth Amendment, totally eroded under the modern day system of tyranny, the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects against unreasonable searches and seizures shall not be violated, and no warrant shall issue but upon probable cause, supported by oath or affirmation, and particularly describing the place to be searched and the persons or things to be seized. TSA, have you ever read that? Fifth Amendment. No person shall be held to answer for a capital or otherwise infamous crime unless on a presentment or indictment of a grand jury, except in cases arising in the land or naval forces or in the militia when in actual service in time of war or public danger. Nor shall any person be subjected for the same offense to be twice put in jeopardy of life or limb, nor shall be compelled in any criminal case to be a witness against himself, nor to be deprived of life, liberty, or property without due process of law. Nor shall private property be taken for public use without just compensation. Sixth Amendment, in all criminal prosecutions, the accused shall enjoy the right to a speedy and public trial by an impartial jury of the state and district wherein the crime shall have been committed, which district shall have been previously ascertained by law, and to be informed of the nature and cause of the accusation, to be confronted with the witnesses against him, to have compulsory process for obtaining witnesses in his favor, and to have the assistance of counsel for his defense. Seventh Amendment, in suits at common law, where the value in controversy shall exceed $20, the right of trial by jury shall be preserved, and no fact tried by a jury shall otherwise be reexamined in any court of the United States than according to the rules of the common law. Eighth Amendment, excessive bail shall not be required, nor excessive fines imposed, nor cruel and unusual punishments inflicted. Ninth Amendment, the enumeration of the Constitution of certain rights shall not be construed to deny or disparage others retained by the people. The people retain the other rights. 10th Amendment, the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively or to the people. So in other words, there's a balance of power, and part of that power remains with the individual and the state. How many of these Bill of Rights have they utterly shredded and eroded and defecated upon under all these pretenses of law they have, including chief among them the indefinite detention bill passed today by the Senate in reconciled form, expected to be passed by President Obama perhaps later today or tomorrow. Remember this day. It is a day to live in infamy. December 15th, 2011, exactly 220 years after the Bill of Rights was ratified in 1791. Now, this next article, as you see behind me, is key to the NDAA controversy over indefinite detention of Americans as well, but from a totally different angle. Paul Joseph Watson with another excellent article, Big Sis orders ICE to prepare for mass influx of immigrants. The directive follows the leaked KBR memo requesting subcontractors to service detention camps. Now, this is part of a longer, older controversy, but Homeland Security Chief Janet Napolitano has told ICE, that is the Immigration Customs Enforcement Agency, to prepare for mass influx of immigrants into the United States, calling for a plan to deal with the shelter and processing of a large number of people. But if you look deeper into the article at the details behind the FEMA camps that do exist in this country, you'll see that they've long used the excuse of mass immigration, an overrun of illegal immigrants, whatever you want to call it. So you ask yourself, why do they allow so many people to come across the border, never seemingly able to enforce the policies already on the books, love them or hate them? And you see that whether it's the building of the KBR Halliburton subsidiary camps in 2006, whether it's Rex 84, or whether it's the U.S. Army War College, they were always preparing for a scenario where illegal immigrants overrun it. Also, the FEMA camp in Taylor, they have the same thing. It's for immigration enforcement. But what is it really for? Paul Joseph Watson reports that Rex 84, short for Readiness Exercise in 1984, was established under the pretext of a mass exodus of illegal aliens crossing the Mexican-U.S. border, the same pretext used in the language of the KBR request for services. However, during the Iran-Contra hearings in 1987, it was revealed that the program was a secretive scenario and drill developed by the federal government to suspend the Constitution, declare martial law, assign military commanders to take over the state and local governments, and detain large numbers of American citizens determined by the government to be national security threats. And it's the same thing here again as they activate the camps in the modern day with the passage of the bill that really declares war on Americans, or at least the potential to detain them indefinitely. And we have a video now from the Rex 84. Let's go to that, please.
Up on screen are photocopies of the Miami Herald, and this goes back into the 1980s when they had congressional hearings dealing with shadow government and martial law. There's the headline, the secret government, and it talks about secret summits, a plan to take over the government. And it shows the people that were in charge of the continuity of government, Dick Cheney and others. And then we have a congressional hearing where we have Congressman Jack Brooks and others during Iran-Contra bringing up the secret plans, and they're told by Congressman Inouye that that can't be discussed. It's a national security issue.
In the 1980s, the concentration camp program got a big boost.
Colonel North, in your work at the NSC, were you not assigned at one time to work on plans for the continuity of government in the event of a major disaster?
Mr. Chairman.
I believe that question touches upon a highly sensitive and classified area, so may I request that you not touch upon that, sir?
I was particularly concerned, Mr. Chairman, because I read in Miami papers and several others that there had been a plan developed by that same agency, a contingency plan in the event of emergency that would suspend the American Constitution. And I was deeply concerned about it and wondered if that was the area in which he had worked. I believe that it was.
May I most respectfully request that that matter not be touched upon at this stage. If we wish to get into this, I'm certain arrangements can be made for an executive session.
And tragically, the only member who got close was Jack Brooks, and he was stopped by the chairman. But the truth of the matter is that, yes, you do have those standby provisions, and the plans are there, and the statutory emergency plans are there, whereby you could, in the name of stopping terrorism, apprehend, invoke the military, and arrest Americans and hold them in detention camps.
So there you have it, that clip. Now, so if Rex 84 is just to deal with an overrun of illegal immigrants, why build the camps? Why not just try to enforce the border or something else? Of course, that's a complex question, not a one-dimensional answer, but maybe the answer has to do with they just want a trigger for martial law so they can clamp down on whoever they want to, just like in any other tyranny around the world for hundreds, if not thousands, of years. It's just textbook. And of course, we also have quotes in that article dealing with the U.S. Army War College's Strategic Institute plan leaked in 2008, where they deal with massive civil unrest implied here for economic reasons, where they would use the defense establishment to reorient priorities in extremis to defend basic domestic order and human security. And that's in the report. That's something else we've covered in the past, but really shows you what road we're going down, dark day indeed. Meanwhile, the SPLC has admitted to lying about Sheriff Mack, and he has a lawsuit pending. We wanted to cover this briefly because Sheriff Mack was very upset about, well, not the first time, of being taken out of context and just told outright lies, implying that he calls for violence when in fact he doesn't and never did. He spoke directly, however, with Mark Potok, head spokesman for the SPLC, the Southern Poverty Law Center. Mack says Potok admitted to him, "We went back and reviewed the tape where we reported you advocated shooting agents, and that isn't what you said." Potok agreed to reprint a retraction. However, Mack says the retraction was a tiny paragraph compared to the massive coverage they had given to the earlier false charges about him, and it could not even begin to undo the vast damage they've done in smearing his name and the CSPOA before other law enforcement agencies. Mack pointed out that Sheriff Dwight Nothstein of Carbon County, Pennsylvania, for instance, has publicly compared Sheriff Mack to Hitler and repeated the SPLC charge that he has advocated shooting federal agents. So at least they reprinted printed a retraction, even though they're constantly smearing patriots. We covered a few weeks ago with Stuart Rhodes how they imply him and many others are white supremacists up in Montana, when in fact there's nothing of the sort going on. Just something else to watch. Sheriff Mack, who, by the way, fought at the Supreme Court level illegal gun control attempts when he was sheriff. Very nice guy. We've had him on the program before. In other news, the USDA conspires with biotech industry for complete deregulation of GMOs. That's an article from Barbara Peterson at Farm Wars. She quotes from Truthout, "Under a new two-year pilot program at the USDA, regulators are training the world's biggest biotech firms, including Monsanto, BASF, and Syngenta, to conduct environmental reviews of their own transgenic seed products as part of the government's deregulation process." So the lack of oversight that currently exists for GMOs will be at an even lesser threshold, as they will be asked to regulate themselves, because basically it would be too tedious to do an environmental impact survey, and that would clog up their ability to sell and otherwise push their ill-gotten products onto the market. Well, what do you expect? We know it's a revolving door between the various regulation agencies and government and these biotech firms, who, by the way, BASF, a good example of how it goes back to the cartel, that is IG Farben, and which also connects with the Bilderberg Group, where groups like Syngenta meet annually, as do Monsanto, at least time to time. Something else to keep an eye on. They will now be regulating themselves and telling you that their products are good for you, but they don't need to label them. Now, a different story. Inside Wukong, the Chinese village that fought back, an interesting profile of a small town of 20,000 people, a coastal fishing village town in China. For the first time on record, the Chinese Communist Party has lost all control, with the population of 20,000 in the southern fishing village now in open revolt. And it goes on to discuss how they ran off the party members from the small town after they began stealing their land and privatizing it and selling it to various commercial interests. And they finally had enough after several years, and 3 months ago began a standoff, and the last Chinese official did finally leave. It adds that although China suffers an estimated 180,000, quote, mass incidents a year, it's unheard of for the party to sound a retreat and actually leave an area that's just in this small town. But, sorry, that's the wrong copy. I had a better markup Anyway, it's a complex story, but in essence, they positioned the town to appoint 13 leaders to deal with negotiating with the police, who put their town under siege through a long standoff and struggle. But then they kidnapped five of those members. One of them died in custody, and that is basically when the town lost it and pushed out all the other authorities and began to regulate themselves and found they were better off for it, even though more than 1,000 police surrounded this town of 20,000, not letting food, water, or fishing boats in or out, or any of the villagers. Nevertheless, they think they have enough food for the time being and are trying to resist the Communist Party's control, although it's certainly not over yet. Interesting story up on the London Telegraph. Of course, it's almost Christmas time, and this holiday season we have some very special discounts for PrisonPlanet.tv. You can get a yearly subscription, 44% off the regular price at $39.95. It's great. You can share it with five of your friends, contacts, perfect strangers, whatever. Let them see the information. You can get an even better deal, in my opinion, 70% off for $129.95. That membership, that you can share with five people, plus 18 physical DVDs in the shiny plastic wrapper. You can give to friends, family, or, as I said, perfect strangers. Give the gift of information and truth rather than, you know, Chinese-made plastic junk and all the rest of it that comes with the holiday season. Right now, we're going to go to break. We'll be back with the Guenter Spens interview. You don't want to miss it, about how tyranny has dawned on America and what it was like in East Germany. Thank you and good night.
What's up with these sorry politicians? Lots of bark. When it's showtime, whimpering like little shih tzus. You want big cuts. Ron Paul's been screaming it for years. Budget crisis? No problem. Got $1 trillion year one. That's trillion with a T. Department of Education? Gone. Interior? Energy? HUD? Commerce? Gone. Later, bureaucrats. That's how Ron Paul rolls. Want to drain the swamp? Ron Paul. Do it.
I'm Ron Paul, and I approve this message.
If you believe in this information and want to support its viral spread, go to the InfoWars store at InfoWars.com. We've got the new G.I. Joe InfoWars t-shirts. We've got the incredible Pro-Pure gravity-fed filters available at InfoWars.com in the store. We've got a new DVD, Sinus Under Attack, the Don't Tread on Me flag. We've got all sorts of different bumper stickers to help spread the rebellion virally. It's all there, wristbands, citizen rule books, in every order. Order online at InfoWars.com today. The water filters, the canteens, it's all there, InfoWars.com. Welcome back. It's the second half of InfoWars Nightly News on this December 15th, 2011 edition. And Guenter Spens is our guest. I interviewed him yesterday on the syndicated radio show, and now we've got him here for the TV show. He lives in Dallas and has been here in the United States for 13 years. He came here as a software engineer working for oil companies, and he was right in the middle as a lieutenant colonel at the highest levels of where the military stand down began in East Germany, which has been vaunted for its incredible surveillance police state. And talking to him on the radio, and I've seen parallels in the research myself, but I didn't live it, the United States has surpassed East Germany in many respects. And so he's here to break down his experiences there and now parallels to what he sees in the West, promoting torture, secret arrest, military drones to be used against the American people. Guenter, thanks for coming in.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you. Wow, well, we had a great talk on the radio, but this is commercial-free now. It was a solid interview. You made a lot of great points when we were getting, you know, water and coffee and stuff that you didn't make on the radio about, Alex, you know, we started bad in East Germany with no rights and then developed some and stood down. You're going the opposite direction. You have all these great rights where the people are the power. Well, I mean, yes. In your own words, break down where we left off on the radio with the parallels here in the West.
I am born in 1952. In the beginning of East Germany, actually a German Democratic Republic, let's say East Germany is shorter. Beginning of East Germany, the party was in total power. The law was there in place, constitution in place, but the party ignored everything. So when you criticized the party or the government, which was the same, you were locked up, you disappeared, just no right at all. And later, you had more and more right. It was We have the other side of the border was West Germany. And East Germany was not accepted from the beginning as a country. So they had to have good documents and have to look nice, let's say this. Yeah.
So for public relations reasons,
yes, for public relations,
kind of like the UN claims all these rights, but then takes them away in Article 30.
But the body had to change piece by piece. The people got more right. The Stasi, which was the Secret Service, was no more in, was still in power, powerful enough, but they had at least to two, like following the rules and the law.
Pay lip service.
Yes, when they would arrest you, they had to find a reason, which was easy. Yeah. But at the beginning, they did not even have to have a reason or show you a reason or tell you one. When I see here the development, the US started with a constitution, the best ever written in history, in human history. And when you see what's going on, Patriot Act is, you lose more and more right. And many of the law and the bills they passed, yeah, are against the constitution. Patriot Act is absolutely against the constitution. And the Patriot Act is the same as we had when the party was in absolute power, because they just lock you up if you want. And they don't tell you a reason.
You're saying our Patriot Act is how East Germany started when it was even more draconian, and then people over time demanded more liberties, and it was that 40-year process until it finally fell.
Yes.
And I've studied history. I didn't live in East Germany, but I've looked at other nations. Only North Korea on the books has stuff like what we have on the books. Hitler, Stalin, Mao, and others, they wouldn't put the things we put on the books now. Our government puts things like the NDAA passed last week, where they say citizens can disappear, never be seen again, military can be used against you. And they went to the senators who authored it and said, does it really say this? And they all said, yes, it does. So even the media couldn't believe it. And then it passed 93-7 in the Senate. And then it turned out Obama had demanded that actually be in there. So I mean, just to recap what you said on the radio, but I want you to repeat it in your own words. The United States, at least on paper, has less rights and freedoms now and is going in the opposite direction of how we started and is actually starting to dwarf East Germany.
Yes, it's exactly what I see here. I mean, I watch the politics. I have to watch it because I'm here 13 years. It's completely new for me. I read the Constitution. When you see Patriot Act in Constitution, no, they cannot lock you away. You have the right for trial. You have the right to see evidence against you. And this is no more necessary.
And you teach Constitution classes now.
Yes.
Well, that's awesome. So continuing the parallels, though, from what East Germany was like and now what you see happening here.
East Germany, as I said, completely power of the party, but it changed over the time. The constitution from East Germany was actually a good written document, clear, but all constitutions are, even East Germany, was designed or written to tell the government and define how the government can rule the people. The Constitution of the United States is completely different. The Constitution starts with we the people. It is written for the people, and it regulates the right of the government. It narrows them so the government has no much right. The states have a lot of right, Bill of Rights, yeah? Government not. But the government grabs all the rights, even from the states and from the people.
So again, what you're saying is key here. In fact, I can show people a drawing real quick with a document cam of this. We were just showing your military ID and passport and things there. In a draconian system, the Constitution can say whatever it wants, but the government has all the rights at the top, and it's all about the government's power over the population who's down here. You got the little ones here, I guess. but instead, in our republic, it's all about the people on top, and the government and the system is under them. And so the Constitution bounds down the government, not the other way around, basically.
The government has to serve the people by our Constitution here. In East Germany, it was a different way.
Exactly, because you can have all these great things you say, but if the government still is in control, can do whatever it wants, it can just violate it.
They run your life. They tell you what you have to do exactly, no way around. There was a time in East Germany when you would move from one city to another. You need authorization and permission to do so. No more at the end, at the beginning. Total control. But It changed piece by piece, and at the end, the people were able to go in the street and have a rally against the body, against the government.
We're going to talk about the fall of the communist system in East Germany, but we covered that first on the radio, so I want to get into the parallels first that we covered last. But, I mean, again, continuing a drawing here, just a primitive drawing, here is authoritarianism on this side, and then you've got on this side the Constitution, Bill of Rights, you know, the flower of the Renaissance, the awakening, all the liberties we met. What Homeland Security is pushing is diametrically opposed to what the Republic was set up on. So you've got tyranny here, and you've got the Republic here, two completely separate things. This state's Declaration of Independence, it's not just a right, it's a duty to overthrow this, and that governments are constituted amongst men, and that it comes from the people, and this is saying the state can do whatever it wants. I mean, it's really simple when you actually look at it.
It is, and it happens on a daily basis.
Again, I can ask a lot of questions here, Guenter, but I want you to get into other parallels, points, warnings, because you're obviously here and speaking out because you want to warn Americans because you've experienced authoritarianism.
For example, I heard America, land of the free. Oh, sounds good. But when police sees me with this shirt, which actually means I'm an oathkeeper, and oathkeeper means we took an oath to defend the Constitution, American people. And when you stand to this, yeah, they are afraid. One police officer told me, as I asked him if there's a problem with it, he came back and said, I don't want to become a target. He is afraid to become a target when he speaks out for the Constitution. Friends of mine say, oh, you are oathkeeper. You should step back. You will lose all your freedom. There is no freedom to lose when this is the case. Already lost, yeah?
Exactly. You don't get your freedom by groveling to tyrants.
Yes.
You only have your freedom by demanding it.
Mm-hmm. And when you see Patriot Act, I guess Thomas Jefferson said, when you exchange security for liberty, you will have none of them.
And history shows that.
Mm-hmm.
Continuing, what got you politically aware and concerned to start speaking out?
When you say, let's say, Constitution, you become a terrorist. I mean, when you are a soldier and come back, a returning veteran, Napolitano, Department of Homeland Security, said, they are potential terrorists. Our soldiers who are coming back are potential terrorists. This cannot be.
They're guilty until proven innocent.
No question. This cannot be. So you lose all your rights. You can be arrested for any reason. You may be on a lot of lists. You know? They can be used maybe later against you. Why? There has not to be a list. Yeah? As long as you are not convicted for any crime or anything else, yeah? There is no reason. Absolutely.
And again, you're an oath keeper because you moved here as a software engineer. Mm-hmm. You say you told me privately you like Dallas, you like Texas, you like America. And you've already been an oath keeper. You were there as a lieutenant colonel.
Yes.
I should tell the viewers, in the main city where the stand down began and where the Berlin Wall fell.
Yeah. When the rally started in Leipzig, I knew about it. I was still in the army. But I was there Monday, listen, look what's going on. Later, I joined them. Not in uniform, of course not, yeah. But in civil, I joined them, and many of our officers joined them too. I mean, I saw them on the street, yeah, Mondays. So there are, but our regulation in the army says clearly we did not have to obey any order against the Constitution, against our people, and against common international law. It was written in the regulation of service. So it was pretty clear, yeah.
And again, you pointed out to me on the radio, but then more privately, when it began, they just did whatever they wanted. Slowly, people quietly demanded more rights until the point they created a constitution and things, but still tried to ignore it. But you guys said, no, we're not supposed to fire on our own citizens for no reason. We're not going to do this. And you told me previously, it's famous, they would machine gun people trying to get out of East Germany.
Yes, absolutely. The border was closed since 1961, 13th of August. And at the beginning, a lot of people who tried to leave died, were killed at the border. Later, no one tried it anymore. They find different ways over embassy and other countries to go out. And this came to a big problem for East Germany. So, and then in 1989, in early spring, they started the rallies beginning after the church. Just a few people, but every Monday, it became more, more and more. And the party has not the power to go against them. They tried it. They put the paramilitary troops with AK-47s without ammunition on the street, just to make a point, you know, a statement. And later they tried to use the army. They trained the paratroops and brought them to Leipzig. But finally, the last rally was on the 9th of November, 89. There were 150,000 people on the street. And it was peaceful, absolutely peaceful, no window broken, nothing. Yeah.
In fact, here's some photos. There are the little crosses where people were killed, where the Berlin Wall was. We'll put it back up.
Oh, yes. This is the site from West Berlin.
Does that bring back any memories?
Yes, I have seen it there. I've been in the wall later.
But before we look at more parallels, we didn't really flesh out, you know, I had always read about the Stasi once the wall fell, scattering like roaches, mm-hmm. the authoritarians, the control freaks. But you said that they already started disappearing before.
Yes, they started before. That was one problem I had later, because I left the army, I actually in July, but I had to stay until end of November, it's like the fiscal year. So, but documents were written, I was out of the army, still an officer, but not just parts in service. So, and Stasi did the begun in, so far I know, in the spring, and moved their people out from the Stasi over to the army, so they became army officer, and no more Stasi. They moved them out in positions in the economy, in key positions, away from the Stasi. So the idea was, we are still there in power, even when the regime changed.
It's like a sleeper network.
Yes, like this.
Stay behind network.
They called them officer in a special service. And this was the same time I got my documents, and I had to show I am not one from them. I left the army, because normally I could not leave the army. I had to stay 25 years in the army.
But just to be clear, were the Stasi all routed out? I mean, I know a lot of them came over and run Homeland Security now, and that's not a joke, folks. That actually happened. But, I mean, were they routed out?
Yes, they were in completely different directions. Some in the army, some there. And the Stasi exists until the end, yeah, officially. Just he moved a lot of people out, so save them and keep them in position for later.
Sure. And we showed a photo earlier of a man machine gun trying to climb over the wall, not into another country, but into his own country, West Germany. I mean, that'd be like putting a wall up the Mississippi, blocking the east from the west and the west from the east. This is not like people trying to come in from Canada or Mexico or whatever. But expanding on that, I know they killed a lot of people. They tortured a lot of people. I'm going to get your view on the film, The Lives of Others. I don't know if you've seen that.
I've seen it.
But having communists over what films could be made, what could be done, you know, demanding all these favors, the type that worked for the system, that enjoyed that corrupt power. But simply put, the mafia never did too well in Texas, because if you tried to shake somebody down here, they would just kill you.
Yeah.
And so my question was, what about Stasi being hunted down by people they'd done wrong? Because it seems to me in any system, if somebody did something to your wife, your children, you're going to kill them. Even if you don't have a gun, I'm going to beat their brains out. I mean, what happened in the oppression there? Did people ever fight back, or did they ever go after them?
This never happens. No one in East Germany had a weapon, guns. There was no firearms in all East Germany. Mm-hmm. Not even all officers, army officers, had a gun at home. It was the exception. I had one all the time, but this was an exception because depend on your service. So there were no power the people could use, and it changed piece by piece, and they got more rights, and they had at least to provide some, call it evidence. Even if it's not evidence, you can provide anything. Yeah,
and prepare. So over time, even though the people were disarmed, they put pressure on the government to bring more liberty.
It would be different when West Germany not exist. because the families were, most of the families were separated. Apart lived in West Germany, were living, apart were living in East Germany. There was contact, West Germany, they could come over for some event, vacation, but not from East Germany in the other direction. So there was connection there. You could see the TV from West Germany, because Germany is not big.
Yeah? And you were telling me that was illegal.
Yes, it was illegal for officer, police, army, and illegal for teacher.
But didn't that make people automatically want to then?
Of course.
Yeah.
It's always the same.
You probably misunderstood what I was saying, because I talk fast and there's a language barrier. I'm saying, gun or not, if you did something to my family, I can kill people with my bare hands. I can kill somebody with a hammer, with a knife. I mean, yeah. did people ever strike back?
No, never. Never, ever. It started with total power. When you try to strike back, you would be gone.
Well, that's right. Germany had been completely bombed. Stalinist Russia had taken over. Mm-hmm. What was the real control of Russia and the Soviet Union over Germany? How did that work through the Stasi and through the government?
It changed over the time. The Stasi and the government worked together. The Stasi and the other services like KGB and this, you know, KGB, they worked together all the time. When I moved for vacation just to Bulgaria, to the Black Sea, I had to apply before, even was our part of the Iron Wall, yeah, the Iron Curtain. I had to apply, I had to tell what time I will go through to what checkpoint exactly, and I had to use this road in the checkpoint, because they checked me, you know, it's a nice document, so they saw who I am, and they called back, so our bases knows exactly what border I went past and where I am. Was total control.
So the Soviet GRU and KGB just
worked very well together.
All came together.
At the end, Romania was falling later, and the Stasi moved a lot of documents, including most of my documents they have about me, moved it to Romania, just to keep it away.
That was a point we never talked about. Your revolution was peaceful to a great extent,
because
the military stood down and said no. It wasn't an attempted coup like the Weimar and the military against Hitler. What about Romania and what happened around that time with Ceausescu? That was where the military stood down and they killed him.
Yes, this was completely different. Ceausescu tried to use the army. The Stasi, this part of Stasi, his own secret service was full on his side. There's no question about. But the army not. He tried to use the army, but he refused. And later, the army went against Ceausescu for the people, and supported the people and killed Ceausescu.
Which is, and he was terrible, obviously. But
absolutely,
some would say a lot worse than what was in East Germany. But that's a lesson, though. That's why the police and military obviously are so important, because they're where the rubber meets the road. I mean, tyranny will come to your door in a uniform.
Yes, an army should never ever go against their own people, because it's not the service of the army. And when we say now the army can be used to arrest some people, this is not right, for my opinion. We have a law enforcement for this case, and we don't need an army in their own country to arrest their own people.
Well, you mentioned secretly being arrested and disappearing in the first years of total power of East Germany and the communists. Now, as you said, America's going in the direction of tyranny, and of course, Germany was going in the direction of liberty. In the last 10, 12 minutes we've got, Mr. Spens, I want to give you the floor to look right at that camera out there. I think this is the camera he's on. Yeah, right here. And, you know, to have the floor as a Constitution teacher, as somebody who loves liberty, from your experiences, you're here to warn America about the parallels that you see. If I hear you say something that I can't understand, I may stop you and, you know, ask you to repeat it. But specifically, you're saying, in many respects, America has surpassed what you grew up in, what you were a colonel in, what you saw, and then tie it all together with the choice our military and police and others have to make. So, you've got the floor. Talk to folks out there.
In East Germany, the army had clear order not to go against our people. This was absolutely clear, and there was no question about. The party tried to use all the power they have, but we got more and more liberty, more rights. It was written from the beginning, but the party ignored it. When I look here, and I watch politics very well because I'm new here, just 13 years. I never heard before anything from inside the United States. So I read the Constitution, the Declaration of Independence, and of course the amendments, especially the Bill of Rights. And I compare what is going on. And actually, I would apply for U.S. citizenship. I have a green card. After a time, I could apply. When the time came, I decided not to apply because of the Patriot Act. So the Patriot Act is the same, not the same, but similar, what I know from the beginning of East Germany. You can be locked up. They throw the key away. They don't tell you any reason about it. And you have not even a right to ask for any evidence. This cannot be. And it is absolutely against the Constitution. So, therefore, I'm very interested in the Constitution. And for my opinion, it's the duty of every American to read and understand the Constitution. Because this is the basis. And it is violated every day, almost every day. And when it comes to the point that people are afraid to speak out the truth and say, oh, I will not become a target, or I will lose my liberty and my rights and my freedom, something is wrong. And it's getting worse and worse, from my opinion, at least from the point of view I see it. Yeah? Because I have seen this before, and it went over the years in the right direction. We got more liberty. At the end, the party was out of office, government out of office, in a peaceful way. Here it looks completely different. When the army will be used against the people, something must be wrong. And when you don't know the Constitution, don't know your rights, and the Bill of Rights, and the rights of the states, of course, you know, when you don't know this, you don't realize that you are losing it. You lose it and you don't realize it until it is too late. You know? When you get arrested for no reason. This cannot be. The Constitution says clearly what has to happen. You have the right of a trial. They have to provide for you evidence. And not just take someone, don't tell him why, and lock him up. This is going on here. At least the documents are there to do so. And the documents are new, so it's getting completely in the wrong direction. And this should not be. When people are afraid to speak out, what is the First Amendment worth? Nothing. Then you can forget your constitution. And this is the basis for this country. Therefore, America became the greatest country in the world. But not by taking the rights from the people away. This is not the way it should be. And it happens. From my opinion, as I said, it's the duty of every American to read and understand the Constitution. This is the law of the land on the highest level.
Well, to use another German parallel, just to interject, look at Hitler. There was a clear Weimar Republic modeled after the British and U.S. model, good constitution, but Hitler got in through the system and then dismantled it. And it's another example of you get rid of your Constitution, Bill of Rights, binding down the government, it's over.
Yes.
Because you're always going to have bad people that want to abuse things.
Mm-hmm. The Constitution is there to keep the government on a level they have to do, they have to service the people, and avoid the government grabbing all the power. They have not to run our lives. This is not the reason for a government. They had limited rights, and any government in the world tried to grab more and more rights.
What did you think of the film? I haven't asked you this off air, I'm asking you now for the first time. What did you think of the film, The Lives of Others?
It's very interesting. This is what's about, but it really happens. Huh? And when you look at it, it goes back in the time, it's not the last year.
So isn't that based, that's based loosely on a true story, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yes, it's a true story. Yeah. It is. It is a true story. And they try to collect all the information. Every government tries to collect all the information they can get. Yeah? The question is how they use it. Yeah? And we should try to avoid this. When a government grabs all information, like the Stasi did, for what reason? To use it. In case they need it, they will lock you up, they have something against you. So, and it cannot be, I mean, this has nothing to do with liberty or freedom, and this was in East Germany very well organized. They had 80,000. The population was 60 million. And 80,000 were working for the Stasi and give them information. The same when you are here, you have to report your neighbor if something is suspicious or something against the government.
Yeah, and again, if something's really bad, I know to report it. It's this idea of report everything. Mm-hmm. They're trying to get us, because in America, the snitch culture is like really looked down on. Mm-hmm. Unless it's something really bad, then obviously you report it. But it's this idea of don't report everything, but then don't report stuff on the government, who's involved in incredible corruption. Mm-hmm. If you criticize that, I have an article right here where sheriff has a secret meeting with the citizens in the town about small government terrorists, and they tell them the Tea Party are terrorists. You're not a terrorist for supporting what the founders set up.
Yes.
And even if they were calling socialists, who I don't agree with, terrorists, that's wrong. I mean, even if I disagree with somebody's politics, it's their right. Mm-hmm. But it's always the socialist and the collectivist that try to restrict our speech.
Yes, absolutely.
Why is that? You mean you lived under it?
Just power. The only question is grabbing power as much as they can. Every government is trying to get more power and more people and grow up. Yeah? Every government in the world, not just here, but here is extremely. And actually, it should not be here because the Constitution avoids this.
Well, see, America's been the enemy of the mega elite of banks. Mm-hmm. So they've taken their time taking us over. That's why they want us dependent. How did East Germany try to keep you dependent?
Oh, there are a lot of ways. You are dependent on the government because, for example, your retirement, you get it from government. You don't get it from government, you pay for it. Yeah? But it is regulated by the government. All your rights, when you try to go, for example, in a different country for vacation, you can or you cannot. When you are on sport, actually, and there are some competitions in West Germany, you have to work with the Stasi together or they will not let you go.
So you're treated like children.
Yes.
You'll be walked around by the government minders, which they're doing under Homeland Security, groping us, training us. But you expanded on that just now. You were talking about how they take your money out of your check, but then have a social security system.
Yes.
That's communist. Right, and again, East Germany, I mean, when you look at the parallels of East Germany, this ultimate evil, we're told, and it's just, you go down the list, everything America does now.
Yes,
you just sit there and it's
absolutely.
Like, in fact, give me another document cam shot, guys. Every line, you've got all the little boxes of progressive income tax. That's in the Communist Manifesto. Mm-hmm. Social Security, your check. Government controls your pension. Have that. Public school. Have that. Giant federal power grab, have that. Government Department of Agriculture, have that. We even have the rural affairs. Surveillance, cameras on street corners, secret police, internal checkpoints, torture. I mean, nobody puts it on paper but America. I mean, you just go right down the line. Big empire invading all these countries. I mean, it's just, do what? Yeah, exactly, control of education, it's all there.
It's absolutely clear. Education was full in the hand of the party in East Germany. Same as here at the end.
Obsessed with education, which really means brainwashing.
And to make them dependent, for example, when you have your retirement, there's a limit you can pay. You have to pay, and there's a limit. When you have more salary, 10%, but there was a limit for 600, so 60 mark. And this is the basis for your later retirement. The teacher, for example, he paid the same, but he got a special retirement only when he teaches until the retirement, until he gets retired. So when he gets fired, he loses it. So they are dependent.
So it's stealing your money.
Yes. And they are dependent because when they would go teach different things against the body, he would be fired as a teacher.
And then all that money you put in stolen.
And he loses it. And the army was different. I should, not now, it's over, you should have a higher retirement, but they had to pay for it. It was not a gift because you served the army. You had the right to pay more into your retirement account. So a lot of these steps, when you would work in a computer center, you must be checked by the Stasi. And when you criticize the party, the check will not be positive. You cannot go and work in a computer center. For example, so you are dependent.
And by the
way,
they announced this 8-9 years ago. I saw it on C-SPAN, but now it's started with the unions, who are the little communist. I'm not saying unions themselves are bad, but they've now become, globalist tools. And Homeland Security, you have to get a background check to be able to get a job now in the unions. And Homeland Security, to fly, you have to pass a check. There's no judge, no jury, no conviction. It's a no-fly list. And it's all about being able to travel, being able to work. It's all up to Homeland Security. Is Homeland Security the U.S. Stasi? Is it becoming that?
It looks exactly like. I mean, when you see what Napolitano said, she said returning soldiers, veterans, are potential terrorists. They can fight for the country. When you are back, they are terrorists.
I say she is a terrorist, not even a potential one.
She is one, yes. Because this cannot be. Everything was actually made America grow big and one of the best countries becomes now a criterion you may be a terrorist when you do this.
Yeah, no, is being a real American, what made the country great is now the enemy.
Yes, it's now
because
the enemy.
Because they're a bunch of globalist corporate hired thugs to bring authoritarianism in. They're the enemy. I mean, it's so obvious. If Russians parachuted in and said George Washington is a pig, we'd say, no, you're the enemy. But because they speak like Americans, they actually have the manuals where they demonize the founding fathers, they're obviously the enemy.
Yes. I mean, take the no-fly list. You can be on a no-fly list and you have no idea you are on until you try to fly.
Yeah, no due process. Same thing of just disappearing.
It's exactly the same. You are on the airport, no, you cannot fly. For what? No one told me. When you criticize maybe the government or anyone, and this is your right to criticize them. You must not lie, but you can criticize them. When you do this, you are maybe in one list. And maybe you are automatically on the no-fly list, you don't know.
But I think you hit the key here. We're on the verge of tyranny. They've set up all these draconian things. They've put torture, secret arrest out like it's a good thing. They're trying to sell it, but they haven't implemented it all yet. They're just now starting. We've got to decry it. We've got to say no to it right now, or my God, it's going to be a horrible road.
Yeah. And this cannot be the Congress pass law or bills against the Constitution. They should know it. They took the oath to defend the Constitution, the oath in office. Everyone, the government did this. They ignored. And for my opinion, many of them have no idea what's in the Constitution written.
But from your experience in East Germany, Romania, Poland, tyranny will fall. No matter how much high-tech bull they've got, it's going to fall.
Finally, yes. But the point is here, the start was pretty good. Liberty, freedom, land of the free. And now it goes the other direction. And I see no way back, because the more you lose in the Constitution, the harder will it get to bring it back. When you lose it, it's gone. There's no way back. Try to reduce the government. I don't think so, because the government, the Congress and all of them, they will not vote for reduce the government. It must be reduced by the people, by the power of the people. And in Germany, it was changed by the people on the street.
And this has been a conscious move by the social engineers. They know that this tyranny comes in, the people are going to get mad, so they put in a repressive system. They're ready for that. I mean, it's so cold-blooded, it's so calculating. And to see the stuff we're putting in law, even North Korea doesn't put in law they can secretly arrest you and kill you. Only our government does it and hides it in plain view. I guess the bigger they are, the harder they fall, or the better they are when they turn to evil, the worse it is.
And it can happen here because no one realizes. And this cannot be, I repeat it, this cannot be a law against the Constitution and will pass the Congress. This cannot be, and no one recognizes.
Well, that's my question. How can I have all these training manuals and videos where they sit there, FEMA, with a straight face and says, freedom is bad, founders are bad, Ron Paul is bad, returning veterans are the enemy, because they know veterans may fight back against it. That's why. They know the military turned against Ceausescu and turned against East Germany and tried to turn against Hitler. They know. They know it was the Chinese military finally turned against Mao Zedong and his wife. So they know. That's why they're saying the military is the enemy.
And then 22 million veterans in the United States. That's a lot. And most of them have guns and can handle guns, of course. Yeah? 22 million, about. And I guess they are very well organized in groups, because this is normal, it's an army, former army. So they are afraid about veterans. Therefore, veterans are categorized as terrorists. When you are a terrorist, they can look up you. Just put you away. Or can do anything.
And use spy the army on against you. And everything else. Amazing. Any points you'd like to make before we end this interview? It's been amazing.
I really repeat, every American should, it's the duty of every American to read and understand the Constitution and watch what's going on in their daily life. It cannot be a Patriot Act, will be prized as a war on terrorism and it's the greatest we ever got and law. No, it is against the Constitution. And you can use it against you. This is the reason they have it. Yeah?
And you've lived it. You know
yes.
it when you see it, and this is it.
And you can see it very clearly. I mean, I watch this because I'm 13 years here now, but it's still you for me. I'm not a born American. Yeah?
But have you seen the U.S. change a lot in 13 years?
Yes, a lot. A lot. Try to fly. Compare this with the time 13 years ago. Completely different. You can just go in.
Well, you said on the radio that you guys didn't have checkpoints except on the border in East Germany. You said you said the East Germans, in your own words, would never put up with it being groped.
No, never.
It would have been a revolt in East Germany. Americans put up with stuff East Germans wouldn't have put up with. Who went through a war, the whole country being bombed, the Soviets coming in and taking over, re-education, and you wouldn't put up with it. But we put up with it. Because we're free, so this must not be tyranny.
This cannot be. I mean, there's liberty, there's freedom. And you cannot exchange the liberty for freedom. You will have nothing.
Well, they always say, we're taking your rights to keep you safe.
No, this cannot be. When you lose any right, they take right from you away to make you safe, something is wrong. Something is absolutely wrong.
Well, and like you said, the police officer was interested in your shirt at a gun show. Mm-hmm. You finally said, what's the problem? And he said, well, I don't want to be on a list. He wanted to say hi to you, but he's scared. He knows he's living in a tyranny.
Yes, he knows it. He's afraid. Therefore, he said, I don't want to
Well, you bet he's afraid. They have brainwashing sessions where they, I've got videos, it's Road to Tyranny. They say, George Washington, Thomas Jefferson is bad.
I mean, I know this.
but even when I was sent the tape by the firefighter that was at the meeting, I couldn't believe it. And then I got the manuals. I mean, imagine with a straight face. George Washington is evil. Thomas Jefferson is evil. People that want freedom are bad. And I got new documents this week where they teach them. People that think the government's becoming illegitimate, they are terrorists. I mean, it's like, that's the enemy. When somebody shows up and says freedom is bad, that's the bad guy.
Yes. This should be, but everyone is afraid. Most are afraid. To tell the truth.
So we've got to have courage.
Yeah, you have to have.
Guenter Spens, thank you so much. Is there any way if folks want to contact you, they can get in touch with you?
Oh, yes. By an oath giver, for example.
All right, great. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. I'm going to say bye to folks, and I'll say bye to you before you go back to Dallas. Ladies and gentlemen, that was an amazing interview, and I hope you get it out to everybody. The language barrier, of course, there, I think we breached it and got the information over to you. I've studied East Germany. I've studied it all. What they've got on the books here in the U.S. has never before been done. Most tyrants, in fact, all tyrants, pay lip service to freedom and things. This system doesn't even do that, and we're all in grave danger. Now, that's it for this Thursday edition of InfoWars Nightly News. I want to say great job to the crew. And I want to thank all of you that are PrisonPlanet.tv subscribers. Until the end of the year, we're running the special we've been running for 8 years of 44% off on the yearly membership. If you sign up in the month of December, you pay for 6.7 months, you get 5.3 months free. And we also have another deal. We can get all the DVDs and the membership for a year, $29.95 for the membership and $100 for the 18 films. And you can still order all the films until Sunday night and the Alex Everything Special, which is $99.95, 70% off, and get them all delivered to you before Christmas. So get 18 Christmas gifts at one time and support our operation and get tools to help wake others up at InfoWars.com in the online video bookstore shopping cart. But again, that is it for this edition. Please get this interview with Guenter Spens out to everybody you know. And hopefully if people discover the fact that we're going into deep tyranny, we can reverse this quickly. But the bottom line is police and military are key to contact. Most of them are already awake now, but are scared. Well, what is the point of being a man or a woman and being scared of losing your job or your pension if you speak out? You're not in America anymore. That's the total proof right there of this buffaloing, this intimidation, this cowing that we've gone under. And it is a spirit of defeatism. It is a spirit of enslavement. And it's not the spirit that our founding fathers showed. It's not the spirit that Guenter Spens showed when he was part of the first group to stand down as a lieutenant colonel and not machine gun men, women, and children trying to get out of a communist system that was collapsing. All over the country, they trained the military to fire on citizens. Now that's admitted. I told you back when it was secret. The bankers think they're going to implode this country and conquer it financially and have paramilitary police and military suppress the public. But it's not going to work because we're aware of them, we got the jump on them, and we've been warning people, myself for 17 years, and now, because we planted all those seeds, as we saw the creeping authoritarianism, now that it's galloping and racing, people are listening because we got the jump on them. Thanks to you InfoWarriors, a lot of you that have been with us for years. Just got chills. I tell you, this is grueling work, but it's all worth it. At the end of the day, in the final equation, in the final sum, because we are making history for the side of good. And believe it, we're going to defeat tyranny in this round. And our ancestors are proud of us. And our progeny to come will look back on what we do today as a model to fight the tyranny of their time. This is an eternal battle against evil, my friends. That's it for this edition of InfoWars Nightly News. God willing, we'll see you back tomorrow, Friday night, the 16th of December, 2011. As we get ready to wrap up 2011. Incredible.